Steve Jobs once gave a commencement speech where he revealed a key class in college that really helped to set Macintosh computers apart from the competition. What class do you think it was? Perhaps coding, digital systems, maybe algorithm design? His answer will surprise you. In this video, we'll talk more about this story, how it can help us further answer the all-too-common student question, when will I ever use math? In the first video in this series, we raised the math teaching paradox, that math is used extensively every day, yet it is so hard to convince students that math is useful. This point is brought home by the unsatisfying answers that teachers give to the question, when am I ever going to use this? In this video, we add a few more insights to this paradox. If you really think about it, the when will I use this question is unfair for the teacher. Teachers don't know when you specifically will use it because they can't see into your future. They don't know what interests or applications you'll bump into. The difficulty in answering this question actually lies with an implicit assumption hidden beneath the question, that students have an idea of the kinds of situations that they'll encounter in their life. Then when the response from the teacher doesn't apply to any of these situations, the mathematics seems useless. But it is silly to assume that we know at a moment of reflection the kinds of situations in which we might use knowledge. That just doesn't fit the reality of how we use knowledge. Why? Because we just don't know what we don't know. There are situations when we do know what we don't know. Take learning a trade, for example. Maybe you'd like to learn how to fix AC units, and the things you learn in your How to Fix AC Units class are really pertinent to what you want to accomplish, because you know that you don't know how to fix AC units. But these instances are easy to come up with and easy to remedy. If you know you don't know it, then just learn it. But what about the things we don't know that we don't know? We can't make this list because as soon as we recognize that we don't know something, it moves to the I know I don't know this category. There's no way to know what we don't know, and very hard to predict what knowledge might be useful to us in the future. Steve Jobs put it this way, you can't connect the dots looking forward, you can only connect them looking backwards. He illustrated this point with a story he told during the Stanford commencement address in 2005. He talked about dropping out of college, but still taking a calligraphy class that he found very interesting. Then he adds,
none of this had even a hope of any practical application in my life. But 10 years later, when we were designing the first Macintosh computer, it all came back to me. And we designed it all into the Mac. It was the first computer with beautiful typography. If I had never dropped in on that single course in college, the Mac would have never had multiple typefaces or proportionally spaced fonts. And since Windows just copied the Mac, it's likely that no personal computer would have them. If I had never dropped out, I would have never dropped in on that calligraphy class, and personal computers might not have the wonderful typography that they do. Of course, it was impossible to connect the dots looking forward when I was in college, but it was very, very clear looking backwards 10 years later. Again, you can't connect the dots looking forward. You can only connect them looking backwards.
Another example of connecting the dots when looking back comes from a colleague of mine who attended a national conference for technology teachers and was surprised to find that the keynote speaker was a medical doctor who had invented the artificial lung. In his address, the doctor explained that an important experience he had that prepared him to invent the artificial lung was restoring an old car when he was a teenager. During that experience, he learned how the components of a car worked together, and he admitted that the artificial lung is really just a fancy radiator. What I find most interesting about this story is that if any of us were faced with the task of developing an artificial lung, we wouldn't think, I know what I need to do. I need to go rebuild an old car. Because again, you don't know what you don't know. We just don't have enough foresight to know all the situations we will be in or all the knowledge that will be important to us. So there are two kinds of alternatives. Learn all you can so you're as prepared as possible for whatever situation, or learn the bare minimum for the life you think you see for yourself. Either path leads to a self-predicting prophecy of using what you learn or not using what you don't learn.
Babe, listen, you have to want to know, okay? Do it again.
Learning changes how we think, but it also changes what we can see, and so in a very real way, changes the world we live in. By learning and understanding new topics, not just math, we're then able to better see the topic being used in our lives and better able to recognize instances where we can connect or apply the topic. I know a doctor who has a strong background in mathematics. He said that as a practicing physician, he uses the ideas of limits, derivatives, and integrals every day in his work. the core ideas of calculus. He uses them in a myriad of ways and to reason through the large amount of information he faces about a patient. The way he uses these ideas is not the same every day, but time and time again, new situations arise in which he uses them to make sense of what's going on, and it helps him decide about diagnoses and treatments. These core concepts of calculus, to him, are invaluable. This doctor has colleagues that don't understand calculus in this way, and they can't see any calculus problems in their work. Doctors who are not fluent in these ideas do not use these valuable tools. They cannot use them, for they cannot see how the tools exist to help them with their everyday work. Because of my math knowledge, I see math connections and problems all around me. When one of my sons puts on his shirt inside out and backwards, I think of the symmetry groups generated by the actions of his shirt. When my kids are rolling balls across our trampoline, I think of how the paths of the balls could be modeled by hyperbolic geometry, and how the model is also used in the general theory of relativity to describe the path of light across long distances. But these connections don't go the other way. People don't sit on trampolines and ask themselves about what connections it has to hyperbolic geometry. They don't think about what connections there could be to abstract algebra and group theory when they see an inside-out t-shirt. Yet these might be the same people that say that advanced math has no connection to real life. Well, in a way, they're right. It has no connection for them, because they don't know enough to see the connections. These two previous ideas are connected to one final point, a complaint that comes up a lot in school. Students often complain that they have to learn things or memorize things that they could just look up. Why learn that formula or theorem or definition? Can't I just look it up later if I need it? Well, students certainly can look them up. That's not the point I'm debating. I look up information like that all the time. The problem is that you can only look up things that you know you don't know. But you can only know that you don't know these things if you had previously known about them. I know, now I'm sounding a bit like Jack Sparrow.
If we don't have the key, we can't open whatever it is we don't have that it unlocks. So what purpose would be served in finding whatever need be unlocked, which we don't have, without first having found the key what unlocks it?
So you have to know a topic well enough to know what to look up, and you need to have enough related knowledge and skills to make sense of what you read when you look it up. Thinking that you can just look up information that you need quickly leads to a fallacy. If we don't need to learn things that we can look up, then once we have a smartphone, there's no need to learn anything anymore, since we could look up anything anytime. So long, school. But what then becomes of the knowledge that forms our everyday thoughts? We can only think with ideas that are already formed in our minds. With those ideas in books, websites, podcasts, or videos, they're not available for us to think with until we've digested them and made them a part of us. Taken together, all our insights about the when will I ever use this question really points to a whole different view of learning and knowledge. One that turns students from assuming that they know what they don't know to acknowledging that they don't know what they don't know. We can't anticipate what knowledge will be helpful for us in the many different situations we may encounter. So we should be hesitant to make judgments now on knowledge that may or may not be useful to us in the future. Knowledge allows us to see the world differently, and the less educated we are, the more limited we are in seeing the world around us and the connections that can be made. And even though we can look up information, the thoughts we think are formed by the knowledge and the world models that are in our mind, not what we can look up on our smartphones. So maybe the best way to answer the "when will I ever use this" question is really to help students understand the real way in which knowledge and learning are used in life. That we use what we know and don't use what we don't know. Let me end with this experiment to illustrate. Take the time to memorize this quote attributed to Thomas Edison. We often miss opportunity because it's dressed in overalls and looks like work. Memorize it by repeating it every morning and evening. Do this for 2 weeks and pay attention to how many times that quote comes to mind throughout the day. For the vast majority of you, it will come to your mind and you will use it multiple times. Here's the interesting part. You could have looked up the quote at any time and read it, but without learning it, you wouldn't have stopped at those same occasions and thought, I wonder if there's a quote that I could use right now. It would have never occurred to you. You can't make the connection to knowledge you don't know. And Steve Jobs would agree. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.